it done, go out and challenge five more of your friends to do it. Let's use, you know, that social media viral stuff going on here to fight this virus, right? If we can get this to go viral, we can fight the virus. So next, Ramadan. Today, Ramadan begins. So first of all, we want to wish well and happy Ramadan to the folks who are going to be celebrating that. And just like we did with Easter, please celebrate with just the folks in your household while we're staying home and staying healthy. That's important. And then finally, we've got a couple of guests who are going to be joining us today. Steve Wellman, who's our Director for Agriculture. He's going to be talking about some ag updates. Karen Vincent is going to be talking about some updates with regard to WIC, Women, Infants, Children Program. I'll first call Steve up here. He's going to be talking about a variety of ag updates, one of which is that we're forming a detasseling task force to work with contractors and seed corn companies around what can be done to make sure we're socially distancing with regard to folks who are doing detasseling here in the state of Nebraska. Detasseling corn is one of those great traditions we have here in Nebraska. It builds teamwork, work ethic, allows young people the opportunity to get that job, helps teachers and so forth over the summer as well. So detasseling is just a part of our culture here in Nebraska. And so now I'm going to call up Director Wellman to say a few words about detasseling and your other ag updates. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Governor Ricketts. So it's springtime. It's planting time. It's time for the farmers to plant our spring crops. It's time for our gardeners to get out in the garden and do what they love to do. It's also time for our landowners to spruce up around the house and their place, do some landscaping, those types of things. And tomorrow is Arbor Day, right? Started in 1872 by J. Sterling Morton to plant trees. So it's a great reminder to plant trees and join the tradition started by J. Sterling Morton. So to do all that planting, we do need supplies, we need seed, people that will have to go out and maybe purchase some plants, go to the nurseries, those types of things. So the Department of Agriculture has issued some guidelines basically to the nurseries and garden centers to give guidance for the COVID-19. Basically, our guidance is follow the steps that we've had in place, follow the suggestions for Governor Ricketts for social distancing. But we also will add to that a little bit. First of all, we do have also the state health directive, and we have the local directed health measures that may be in place. So these nurseries and garden centers need to follow those directed health measures as they set up. In addition to that, we would suggest that they expand their footprint. They give more space for people, the customers, to move around. Maybe they put some tape down. They help direct traffic, similar to what we're doing in the grocery stores and those other stores, and just allow for shopping to take place, purchases to take place, but allow for social distancing and work to crush the curb. In addition to the nurseries and the garden centers, we also we have directives out for farmers markets. The farmers markets are generally this time of year, fairly soon they would start up. And those farmer markets are not something that the Department of Agriculture operates, but we do work with the local entities, whether the cities or whoever organizes those farmer markets. And so we have some guidance out. It's on our website. It's on nda.nebraska.gov. Basic guidance, again, similar to what we're doing with the nurseries and garden centers, but a reminder to not hand out samples of food during the COVID-19 response, to give more space, to have sanitizers out in the area where the consumers are. And let's not forget to remind the consumers and the customers to take precautions to protect themselves, whether it be masks or gloves. You know, only pick up the products that you're going to purchase. And if it's at the farmers markets, the vendors should be the ones handling those goods, and they should have gloves on at all times when they package up the purchases for the consumers. The other thing I would like to talk about is with the farmers markets, we do have, and it fits in quite nicely, I believe, with what Karen is talking about today with the WIC program. The Nebraska Department of Agriculture does offer coupons to WIC-eligible participants, and they can use these coupons at farmer markets. So it's basically $24 per person, and they can get these coupons at the Department of Agriculture, call our staff, and then they can use these coupons at the farmer markets to make those purchases through the WIC program. The governor also mentioned the detasseling task force that we're beginning to set up. We have a great value-added business here in Nebraska with the corn production system and the vital service that the detasselers play in adding that value to our crops here in Nebraska. About 7,000 people participate in detasseling each year here in Nebraska. And we want to make sure that we are doing everything we can to protect that workforce as they come into the fields for social distancing and COVID-19 precautions. So this detasseling task force will be chaired by myself. We have participation from the major seed companies. We have participation from the detasseling contractors, and then we're also will be finalizing that task force with a couple of growers. And we look forward to working through that and making sure that we have the protocols in place for the safety of their workers. You know, last year when we went out and detasseled, the governor and I and some others did, and we had a 20-minute safety training before we went out and detasseled. So I'm sure they're well aware of safety protocol. I know they are, and we'll work to incorporate COVID-19 safety into that protocol for them. And then one last thing on the national scale, USDA has announced recently that there is $16 billion of direct aid to producers that will be forthcoming. The details of those programs are still being developed. Those direct aid programs will be administered by the Farm Service Agency. And then there's also a $3 million program for food purchases, and that will go through.
$3 billion
dollars of food purchasing through USDA Agricultural Marketing Service. So more to come on that, but those are some of the things that are going on with Department of Ag. And one thing on the farmers markets, if they're interested, go to ourbesttoyou.gov, or go to our main website, find the logo that says Farmer Markets, and you can find information about your local farmer markets, where they're located at, and also the vendors that are supplying produce to them. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Steve. And a couple things, Steve mentioned that tomorrow is Arbor Day. Usually that is a state holiday, well, still a state holiday, but I want to assure people that in the Department of Labor and in the Department of Health and Human Services, we will be on working to be able to process applications for folks, for those families who need those services. So even with the state holiday, we will still have people working to be able to make sure we get those unemployment checks out and all the other benefits that come through the Department of Health and Human Services. And speaking of the Department of Health and Human Services, we've got Karen Vincent here, who's going to talk to us about the Women, Infants, Children program, the WIC program, and some of the things that are going on with that program, because USDA has waived some of the requirements. We, here at the state of Nebraska, have followed suit. I've signed an executive order waiving some of those some of the requirements. It's that WIC program serves 33,000 women and children across the state of Nebraska at 100 sites. It's an important program. And so with that, Karen, I'm going to call you up to give us a few more details. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor. So the special supplemental nutrition program for women, infants, and children, or often referred to as WIC, is a federally funded program that does give free healthy foods, nutrition education, and breastfeeding support to income-eligible women who are pregnant or have just had a baby, infants, and children under 5 years old. So as the governor mentioned, Nebraska WIC serves 33,000 women and children each month at over 100 sites across the state, but we do expect that number of women and children served to increase due to the current pandemic. So all caregivers of children up to 5 years old are welcome to apply for their child, and the WIC program often has fathers, guardians, or foster parents apply for their children. With restrictions in place to slow the spread of the coronavirus, many of Nebraska's families may be experiencing temporary changes in income, and WIC may be a program to help put healthy foods on the table for these families, even if a change in income is only temporary. Pregnant women, moms of infants, and families with children up to 5 years old may be able to get foods at no cost through the WIC program. WIC has different food packages that include specific nutrient-rich foods for a pregnant mother, infant or child, or a woman who is breastfeeding or not breastfeeding. WIC has different food packages. Some foods that could be available to families include peanut butter, beans, fresh fruits and vegetables, milk, cheese, yogurt, whole grain bread, whole grain pasta, baby food, and formula. WIC provides an electronic card similar to a debit card that can be used to buy these foods at the grocery store. Families who participate in other programs like SNAP or Medicaid are automatically income eligible for WIC. WIC's income guidelines are generous, and some families may qualify without even realizing it. For example, a family of four with a gross income of $47,638 would be income eligible for WIC. And the best way to know if you qualify is by visiting the website signupwic.com and calling a WIC office near you. You can also find the WIC income guidelines on the Nebraska DHHS WIC website. In addition to free healthy food, families that participate in WIC also get free nutrition and health education. In the past, families would get to meet with a nurse, dietitian, or nutritionist to see how their child is growing, how well mom is gaining weight during pregnancy, and to screen for their iron level. But with new recommendations for social distancing, the USDA has temporarily waived some requirements so services can be provided remotely. Even though families aren't having to come into the WIC office during this time, WIC is still working to help families stay connected and healthy. Nutrition, breastfeeding, and health education is now happening over the phone. WIC families across the state have been very appreciative and are glad that they don't have to come into the office during this time. Even with meeting over the phone, many participants have reported these visits to be very helpful, especially during this time when many families are balancing more responsibilities with children at home, and some may be socially isolated. The WIC program also provides information to families about other services available in their community. WIC is a network of nurses, dietitians, lactation consultants, and other moms who help women with their breastfeeding goals. At each WIC appointment, moms have access to breastfeeding support. So breastfeeding often can be difficult for new moms, and with social distancing restrictions to slow the spread of the coronavirus, many moms may not be able to do as many weight checks for their babies or have the social support of friends and families that they normally would. WIC has been working hard to provide breastfeeding support during this time to help fill that gap for new moms. And WIC breastfeeding peer counselors are moms who have breastfed before, and many WIC offices across the state have groups of these moms who are ready to give a phone call or a text to WIC participants to provide that extra support. During these isolating times, there have been reports that these check-ins have made a huge difference for first-time moms who are starting to breastfeed. WIC can help you to have access to free healthy food, nutrition education, and breastfeeding support during these hard times. So if you or someone you know is pregnant, just had a baby, or is the parent, guardian, or foster parent of a child under 5 years old, visit signupwic.com and call to see if you qualify for the WIC program. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Appreciate it. Thank you for all the work that you and your team are doing to help our families that are in need across the state. So, and thanks for being flexible during this pandemic too to be able to do that. So, as many Nebraskans are. All right. So next, I wanted to hit upon. We have unemployment numbers that are at 12,045. So that is down from the 16,000 the previous week, and certainly down from the high we had at 24,000. But still very very high would be. If you're talking about like the 12,000 we had this week, that'd still be three times more than our previous record before we had the pandemic. So still at a high rate of people signing up for those unemployment benefits. Also, with regard to traffic, the Department of Transportation has relayed some of its traffic. And again, we continue to see Nebraskans following social distancing guidelines and making progress on slowing down their mobility and traveling around. Overall, across the state, traffic is down from what it was last week at -28%, to now this week, down 35%. If you look at Omaha streets, for example, they were down 32% last week, now they're down 38%. Lincoln was down 31%, now they're down 37%. So again, Nebraskans are continuing to stay home, stay healthy, stay connected. That's awesome. We'd love to see that. We want to see that continue. So thank you very much to all the Nebraskans who are working to slow the spread of virus here in our state. And then, let's see, we got schedule for the week. Obviously, we'll have the briefing in English here tomorrow, 2 o'clock p.m. Central Time, our regular time. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we will do our Spanish press briefing, or in Spanish language. And then tonight also on NET, I'll be on from 8:30 to 9:30 with Danette Smith, our CEO for the Department of Health and Human Services, as well as Dr. James Linder from UNMC, and Nebraska Medicine. Okay, so I think that catches us up on all of our agenda. I will now go to our questions that have been sent in. Andrew Mim sends in a question. A listener is now on day 36 and is filing for unemployment. She continues to keep her claim up to date. However, she still hasn't received any money. Others in our office are also still waiting. What is holding up some of the unemployment claims, and what should this listener do? One of the things that may be going on here is that, we talked about the unemployment program and then the pandemic unemployment program. So without knowing the specific details, I can't say for certain on this, but if you did not qualify yet to get the pandemic unemployment, you had to first be rejected from the regular unemployment program, and the software to process the pandemic unemployment assistance became operational today. So we just got that software up and running. So that those processes are running now. So if you were previously applied and were not eligible under the previous unemployment program, we will be running the software now to be able to provide you with the pandemic unemployment program. So that may be one of the cases that's going on here as well. And as I just want to again highlight that we've received a large number of applications, obviously. John Albin, our labor commissioner, has taken his team up from about 34 people as far as claims adjudicators up to 166 adjudicators to help process this. We're still shooting to process about 75% of the applications between 28 days. Previously we were about 97% of our claims being processed in that 21 to 28 day time frame. So we are obviously seeing the impact of the additional claims being processed. Matt Olberding from the Lincoln Journal Star: in many Nebraska towns with meatpacking plants such as Lexington, Dakota City, Crete, Madison, and Madison, it appeared that they may have avoided big outbreaks until expanded testing was done there. With that in mind, and what do you think? With that in mind, and what has been seen in many of the meat processing communities, are there any plans to do expanded testing in places like Schuyler and Nebraska City, which have large processing plants, but have yet to be report very few cases? I think actually one of the things that we look at, and again, this is the whole key for everything we're doing, is about hospitalization rates and making sure we keep those hospital facilities open. And that's what we saw with Grand Island, is that we did the testing. We saw the high rates of people testing positive. We saw that in Lexington. That was kind of our early warning sign. And so we mobilized resources to be able to work with the hospital systems, and they're all working very, very hard. They're doing a great job. But for example, to transfer patients out to make sure there was space available in those hospitals. And that's one of the things. So we certainly will do testing where we need it. We deployed to be able to do that. And we worked those teams around the state. With regard to Nebraska City and Schuyler, I don't have the specific information on when they're gonna be tested, but you can imagine that we will be staying in touch with the local public health departments about their facilities. And when they see something going on, they obviously let us know so we can deploy resources. Grant Schulte of the Associated Press: despite the increase in mail-in ballots, some Democrats are arguing that it's irresponsible to allow in-person voting in Nebraska's upcoming primary. They say it's only being allowed because Republicans don't want to do anything that may help Democrats. Can you address that criticism? We have sent out early ballot requests to every voter in Nebraska, and we are seeing a huge response of people turning in those ballots. And by the way, those early ballot request forms are due May 1st, so you need to get those mailed back in if you want to plan to mail, get a mail-in ballot. And that's a great way to do it. We've been encouraging people to do that. However, we don't want to disenfranchise voters who want to go to the polls. This is something that we have done forever in our state, is allow people to go to polls. We've done it through pandemics, we've done it through wars, and many Nebraskans prefer to vote through polling. So we are not going to follow the Democrats' plan to disenfranchise voters by closing polling. The Secretary of State's been very clear that he has been taking steps to make sure that the polls will be open and we can process this in a good way. We're certainly encouraging people to mail in their ballots if they want, but we're not going to follow the Democrats' plan to disenfranchise voters. Why is it so important to allow in-person voting? I think I just covered that. Based on recent surges in Hall and Dawson counties, are there any plans to extend DHMs in those counties or other parts of the state? The DHMs are coming up due at the end of the month. So Douglas, Sarpy, and Cass counties will be first on April 30th. We have a number of counties that follow on May 6th, including Lancaster, and then the rest of the counties on May 11th. So I'd say we are working on the DHMs that will follow those DHMs that are expiring. So I say just stay tuned. We'll have announcements on those as they are ready. And are we now expecting a peak later peak in cases? Again, if you look at some of the models there, the dates do tend to move around. The whole thing that we are focused on, though, is not about the peak cases so much as hospitalization, right? We want to make sure that every Nebraskan who needs that hospital bed, that ICU bed, that ventilator, can have access to that bed or ventilator. So that's what we're all focusing everything around, is making sure that those are available for folks. Tara Campbell, WWT. Are there any plans to try to speed up processing times for unemployment applications? So, yeah, absolutely. As I've talked about, Commissioner Albin has worked to bring in additional teammates to be able to help process those applications. He's gone out and hired outside firms to be able to help us add staff to those adjudicators. We're up to 166 people now. So we are working to try and get those claims as quickly, processed as quickly as possible. We have the software up now to be able to do the pandemic unemployment assistance program. Again, if you've already applied, you don't have to do anything. We will go back and pick, if you were rejected for the unemployment insurance program, which you had to be able to get the pandemic, we will go back and pick those up and get those processed. How long should someone expect to wait if they've submitted a claim 6 weeks ago? Again, that could be tied back to the pandemic's issues. But again, we're trying to get 75% of those processed within 21 to 28 days. I might point out, I think states like Connecticut's goal is 40 days. So again, people, the systems are receiving a lot more applications than we've ever received before. So Steve White, NTV. Grand Island Mayor Steele said he wants to know about the two medical officials from the state who have toured JBS on Tuesday and their thoughts. So I have a weekly update with Mayor Steele and the Public Health Director, Teresa Anderson. It'll be tomorrow afternoon is when we do that update, so I'll be happy to fill in Mayor Steele with regard to what Dr. Lawler and Sally Schwedhelm discovered when they were at JBS. I haven't had a chance to talk to them. By and large, they've said they've been very impressed with the steps the food processors have been taking. Obviously, there's always room for improvement, and they've been giving them tips on what else they could do. But they've been very pleased with the steps that those folks have been taking. And by the way, the public health departments have been on the daily calls where this has been updated. So the public health department was aware of those visits. Brian Mastery, WWT. How concerned are you when it comes to children who are missing wellness checks and not getting current vaccinations to avoid potential coronavirus exposure? Some doctors believe this could lead to another health crisis. Okay, so I want to unpack that a little bit because there is no vaccination. The way the question was asked, it made it sound like there's a vaccination for coronavirus. There is not a vaccination for this specific strain of coronavirus, COVID-19. There's no vaccination for that. Also, doctor's offices are not closed. So parents can make appointments to go see their doctors. Now, if they go, I'd recommend wear masks and all those things we talk about as far as social distancing and so forth, but doctor's offices are not closed. The one thing we did do is we prohibited elective surgeries, which I don't believe this actually is impacted by, but we also announced those elective surgeries would be open, you know, hospitals can start performing those on May 4th if they were able to show that they had 30% of their hospital beds available, 30% of their ICU beds available, 30% of their ventilators available, and 2 weeks of PPE on site at their hospital. So, you know, again, I think that if parents are holding off, certainly practice those social distancing guidelines, but you can go visit your doctor, and certainly, again, those elective surgeries will be open May 4th. Liliana Pearson from WWT says, I've been speaking with a woman who lives in Omaha. She is a born U.S. citizen, and so are her five children, but she is married to a man who is not a citizen yet. Because they file joint taxes, the entire family does not qualify for stimulus money. She understands her husband is not getting any money, but doesn't understand why she and her children aren't receiving benefits. Again, this is a program that the federal government is doing through the IRS. So we, the state, we're not involved in that one per se. So I'd say probably the best bet is to go see if IRS has a frequently asked questions on that one. I don't know if the IRS has a way that you can reach out to them directly, but it's not a state program, so I'm afraid I can't give you any specifics on that one. And then the governor of California is using disaster relief funds and donations to help families in the situation in his state, and I was reaching out to see if Governor Ricketts is considering doing the same thing. And we actually have community collaboratives who can help families who are in need of assistance, and so I'd certainly refer those families to that. And the First Lady does have a fund that she has set up to be able to help bring relief for families impacted by the coronavirus. I believe a lot of it is focused on the food banks, but I think that, you know, again, that would be something where work through your community collaborative, that would be one of the ways to get assistance if you need it outside of what the state is doing through things like WIC and so forth. So with that, Taylor, do you have questions that were texted in?
Don Walton says, do you think meatpacking plants ought to voluntarily apply your standard of 6 feet separation to their production lines to protect their workers?
So Don Walton, the Journal Star, asked, do I think that food processing facilities ought to apply the 6 foot distance and social distancing with regard to their lines and so forth? I think meatpacking plants and food processors should be doing everything they can to do social distancing. I've said from the get-go that the six-foot rule is something that not every business can do, and that's okay. You have to make sure, though, you're doing what you can to be able to put those common sense social distancing guidelines in place, and I know that's exactly what the food processors are doing, because we just talked about it with Dr. Lawler and Shelley Sweetholm going to visit these facilities and telling me personally they've both been very pleased with what the processors are doing, impressed by the steps they're trying to take here to be able to spread things out. I can share with you some examples. I believe at Lincoln Premium Poultry, for some of the folks, for example, who are cutting up the chicken breast, they're actually building little tents around those people. They're putting up plexiglass between different workstations. They're putting up plexiglass in lunchrooms so that you're kind of eating in a phone booth. They're taking the temperatures of people coming in. Everybody's masked. They're sanitizing surfaces frequently, fogging their locker rooms and that sort of thing. So I know that they're all taking a lot of steps to be able to make sure that they're doing all they can to be able to prevent the spread of virus in their facilities, just like any business should be doing what you can to be able to make that happen. Yeah, Taylor.
Alexander at KTV wants to know if the tests from Nomi Health are FDA approved.
Alexandria wants to know from KETV if the tests from Nomi Health are FDA approved. Yeah, this is not new technology here. This is the PCR machines. This is the polymerase chain reaction machine that is used to be able to detect the antigen. What it's detecting is the RNA. See, I'm using the right term, Dr. Antone, right? Which is what they're looking for from the virus so that they can detect whether or not the person has the virus. So this is the same type of technology that we're using in other labs and so forth. So it's not new technology, nothing experimental. So Woody from KSCG says there's 133 new positives in Dakota County today, and are they connected to one of the food processors? And, I think the thing to remember, folks, is this is a community issue. Now, what do we see in places where we see a lot of spread of the virus? Well, we see people concentrate together, and that's certainly true with our food processors where you have people together, but it can also be true in households if you have multiple generations of people living together or a lot of people living in a household. We see it in places like New York City, just in general, where you've got a big city where lots of people are close together. And I think that we have to focus not only on just what the work sites are doing, but what's also going on at home. So that's why, for example, we're doing the Spanish press briefings on, that we did Tuesday, we're doing in Thursday, is to reach households where English is not the first language. We've got to do a better job of reaching out to those households. So that's part of what we have to do is remember, this is actually a community problem, not just a specific industry or business problem. Okay, great. Yeah.
About the unemployment benefits, Senator Sass is concerned that the federal supplement to the unemployment benefits are paying people more than what they normally make each week, and that is causing some people to not want to return to work. Do you think the payments should be capped at 100% of their normal income?
So the question was, Senator Sass has said that he's concerned that because the pandemic payments with the extra $600 boost and so forth can be more what somebody would make in their regular job, and so that's discouraging people from going back to work. In Nebraska, if your employer calls you back to work and you refuse, you lose your benefits. So it really shouldn't be an issue here in Nebraska. Again, it's really that bump, that extra $600 is really recognizing that this is a unique emergency that we've got here in our country. We want to help families be able to get through that emergency, but it's also not supposed to be that discouragement for working. And so I just encourage everybody, if you actually are thinking that, gee, I'm just going to stay home and collect unemployment benefits because it's paying me more than my job was, if your employer calls you back, take that job. because if you don't, you will lose your benefits. That's the way it works here in Nebraska. And the business is, if you contact somebody and they refuse to come back to work, you let us know, because then we will make sure that that person doesn't get their benefits. In fact, somebody who we offered a job to at the Department of Labor told us they would rather stay home and collect unemployment benefits. And of course, that's the wrong person to tell that to, because we run this business, and so that person's not gonna get their benefits, because you cannot turn down the job opportunity. So I appreciate Senator Sasse's concern, but here in Nebraska, I don't think it's gonna be an issue, because again, if people choose to try and stay home and collect benefits, they're not gonna be able to do that if they're offered a job. Well, the question was, why is it taking 3 weeks to get the new software up and running? If anybody's ever developed software, you know that is record time. And I'm sure there's probably going to be some glitches with it, because, you know, normally it takes a lot longer to develop software and put it in place, especially when you've got a lot of people using it. So, again, we can only act once we know legislation has actually been passed and signed by the president, because then it's finalized, and then we can design software systems for that specific piece of legislation. And frankly, John and his team in the Department of Labor did just yeoman's work to be able to get this up in as quick a time as they did. Yeah, Lee.
You guys mentioned how the 21 to 28 days, you're aiming to have 75% of the unemployment claims sent back. So if you go back 20 to 28 days from these past few weeks, you would step back into last month. Do you guys have the numbers on if you actually are achieving that 75%?
So our commissioner, the question was, do we have the data for the last period that would cover that 21 to 28 days, and what percentage of claims did we get actually adjudicated in that time period? And I've got our Commissioner of Labor, John Albin, here. John, do you happen to have those numbers? What are the most recent numbers for that 21 to 28 day period? You must have it, because you're coming up here. Or you have an answer.
I have an answer. Thank you, Governor. If you look at the official USDOL statistic for first payments, it says we've been at 97% for the last month for payment within those first 21 days. That figure, the way it's calculated, doesn't count claims that are still pending. We have initiated a task force to go back within our own agency to go back and check to make sure if there are any claims that are older from those a month ago that aren't paid or officially resolved, that we will get on them. And as the governor mentioned, we've had 100,000 claims filed in the last few weeks. We have 40,000 of them that have been processed to conclusion. Now 13,000 of those are probably gonna have to go back through the process for PUA, but
the pandemic, right?
Pandemic unemployment assistance. I think we're close. Actual numbers, I don't know. I'll know a lot more this week, because we've initiated some new counting within our own department to try and do a case aging, as if you will, to measure that. But we don't have an exact figure right now.
So I was just for clarification, you mentioned 97%. What exactly was that in relation?
There is a federal report called a 9052 for the Employment and Training Administration that measures when you make a first payment to an individual, it looks back at when that individual made their application for benefits. That number, according to I just ran it on the computer earlier today, is running around 97%. That's overstated by quite a lot, I think, because there are some older claims in there because of the mass. But I think the crew's been doing a pretty good job of keeping up, all things considered. The tidal wave, 40,000 out of 100,000, and when you consider that that's basically a year's worth of caseload in 7 weeks, is a pretty good performance by our team.
Great, thank you, John. Fred.
Governor, you stressed the importance of keeping the meatpacking plants open for the food supply. Is there a tipping point in terms of cases or death where you would make it the decision that it was no longer worth it, involved, and it should be closed?
So Fred asks whether or not is there a point at which I'd say the meatpacking facility should be closed, and we are working with them to keep them open. And so I don't foresee a scenario where I would tell them to close. It really is about their operations, and again, internally they're going to make their own decisions but we're working very hard to make sure they can stay open because it's vital for our food supply. Can you imagine what would happen if people could not go to the store and get food? You want to talk about some of these protests, you know, that are going on right now? Think about when, you know, think how mad people were when they couldn't get paper products. Think about if they can't get food, right, folks? This is why it's vitally important that we keep our food processors open and do everything we can to assure the food supply chain, because we would have civil unrest if that was not the case. So Fred says they could still get food, may not be meat. Trust me, this would cause civil unrest. If you think there's people unhappy right now with the steps we've taken, wait till they can't do that. So again, we got to do everything we can to be able to make sure we keep these processors open. Fred, or sorry, Paul.
So I just want to make clear, so it's 13,000 pandemic claims that haven't gone out yet?
They started processing this morning.
So the question was, Paul was asking, $13 in pandemic unemployment assistance claims that are being processed today, and they started going out today. And the commissioner responded back and said yes. Do you want to come up here, Commissioner? That way the people can see you and hear you on the microphone.
The question is, will it be 21 to 28 days for the 13,000 that we're going to run through the pandemic unemployment assistance program? And the answer is no. I mean, in theory, one could get paid yet today. I don't think that's probably going to occur, but this team's going to be working on it over the weekend to get those claims out. And we've worked out a process so we will get make payments immediately. And if we have to go back and redetermine eligibility, we will do that, but if anyone is initially eligible at all, we will pay them the $174 plus the $600 federal pandemic unemployment, so we'll get $774 out to them as soon as they're eligible, and we're hoping to start paying those the first part of next week at the latest.
Sure, so the question was, we're talking about the pandemic maybe peaking later on, and we're talking about doing a detasseling task force, so a couple things. One, we're gonna be doing social distancing for a while, folks. I mean, until there is a way that we have a vaccination or something like that, that we are not concerned about the spread of the virus, we're gonna be doing social distancing. Now, that's why we wanna start taking steps now to kind of start planning what would that be like for our detasselers, as an example. Dr. Khan will tell you that the models that are out there are not predictive. And in fact, he said that on NET when we had our show a couple, 3 weeks ago. So the and just specifically with regard to the IHME model, that model has moved around all over the place. So again, it's not a predictor. What is real, what is actual, is what's going on in our healthcare system. So we've actually got as I mentioned yesterday, we have a dashboard out there that shows what percentage of our hospital beds are available, what percentage of our ICU beds available, what percentage of our ventilators are available. You know, for example, let's just take Omaha. 38% of the hospital beds are available, 44% of the ICU beds are available, and 75% of the ventilators are available. So that's our major metropolitan area, and we have lots of capacity there right now. In fact, of those ventilators, we actually had 106 people on ventilators yesterday, and now only 89, and 16 of them are COVID. So you can see, coronavirus is really, I mean, that's why we're focused on what we can see and what is real, not on what somebody's model is that, as Dr. Khan said, is not even predictive.
But the numbers are rising, you know, this week you've seen it rise pretty dramatically. And you said the peak would be in late April, mid-May. Are you still seeing that?
So, yeah, so again, the models show, and this is why we say the models, are showing that it was going to be late April or, you know, early May or something like that. But again, okay, so let's go back and look at the data, because I think Henry Cordes did his own article that showed that really a lot of the rise in our cases are really focused in some areas like Hall County or Dawson County, Dakota County, Madison County. So again, they're in places where we have big concentrations of, you know, people who are concentrated close together for whatever reason, whether it's living conditions or workplace or whatever. So again, we have to manage those, absolutely, and we deploy resources to manage that. So, but again, and in all those areas, we've managed it so that we have not overwhelmed the healthcare system. And Hall County is a great example of how CHI has worked really hard. They've transferred patients out, they've brought people, staff in, so we're managing the healthcare system.
So the answer is you don't know?
Well, the answer with regard to the peak is it really doesn't matter so much as what happens with regard to our hospital system. At the end of the day, what we know and what we care about is making sure that every Nebraskan, if they need a hospital bed, it's got one available. If they need an ICU bed, they got it available. If they need a ventilator, it's available.
The rank and file Nebraska wants to know, geez, are we getting toward the end of this? Are we getting, are we at where you thought we were going to be as far as number of cases, or have we?
The question was, are we at where we thought we would be? I would say that we've done very well here in Nebraska. We've flattened the curve. We have not overwhelmed the healthcare system. And that's what we're continuing to manage. Continue to manage it to be able to do that. When we have situations where, like in Hall County or Dawson County, where we have greater need, we're going to deploy resources there. That's how we're going to make sure we don't overwhelm the healthcare system there. And that's one of the reasons why I tell people, we're going to be doing social distancing for a while. Now, as we look forward to May, we're going to look at loosening some of those restrictions, but we're going to do it a step at a time. We're not going to do it all at once. And so, yeah, we're going to be doing social distancing for a while. The real focus is going to be, what are we doing to the healthcare system? So Rob McCartney's question saying, hey, he's got listeners or viewers who are waiting for their unemployment check. They got bills due. We've asked landlords to hold off. Are there other businesses going to do the same? And I would say that, yes. If you've got a business, well, I know, for example, utilities are not cutting off by and large. There may be somebody out there who's doing, but by and large, most of the utilities in this state are not cutting people off because they can't pay. Now, you still owe the money. You have to pay a later date. But they're not cutting anybody off because of those utilities. So that's an example of another business that's taking that step. And I would encourage all businesses, if you know somebody who has been impacted by the coronavirus, use your good judgment and common sense about how you want to treat that person. Remember, we're all going to get through this, and you're going to want that customer back at some point. So do the right thing now. Dr. Antone, can you give us an update on the total number of patients transferred out of CHI Grand Island and just bring us up to date where they are?
So I'll give two updates, one on CHI Grand Island and one in Lexington County Community Hospital. So I'm in daily communication with the CMOs of both hospitals, CEOs of both hospitals. For Grand Island, things are really stabilizing out now. They did not have any transfers out of Grand Island St. Francis Hospital yesterday. And they still maintain about 12, 13 patients in their 16-bed ICU. So good situation happening in St. Francis, things really under control. Of course, that was because they had the cooperation of all the other hospitals in the CHI system, as well as throughout the state of Nebraska. So CHI St. Francis seems to be doing very well right now. Lexington is Dawson County, and they've had an increase in their visits to the emergency room over the last several days. And yesterday, for instance, they did have to transfer 5 patients out. Yesterday, they were transferred to the North Platte Great Plains Hospital. Again, great cooperation. They were all done by ground transport. They've also had some transfers to Good Sam Hospital in Kearney, and those hospitals are doing fine. We have ground transport and air transport available for Lexington, should that be necessary. All hospitals in Omaha, all hospitals in Lincoln, Scotts Bluff, North Platte, Kearney, all collaborating to accept patients if that should be needed. So far, a stable situation as far as the healthcare goes. Oh, how many total have been transferred out of Grand Island? I would just offer my best estimate here and say probably about 15 patients in total over the last 2 weeks have been transferred from Grand Island St. Francis.
And Lexington, you said 5 to 1 place, and you said there were some other places.
Yesterday, all 5 went to Great Plains Hospital in North Platte. The day before, they went to Good Sam Hospital in Kearney.
So how many of those?
I think it was 3 to Kearney the day before.
Yeah. You look at those 15 that were transported out, is that because of further
So the question is for the reason for the transport of any type of patient, either Grand Island or Lexington or any hospital, why they would be transferred out? Number one is both answers, both for other medical care, such as when a patient no longer can be oxygenated well enough using a ventilator, they need to be transported down to Omaha, either CU Medical Center, Bergen Mercy Hospital, or UNMC, to go on a device called extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, which requires special techniques, special care, in order to get that patient oxygenated. For instance, the first patient that we had in Nebraska actually needed to go on extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, and she's doing well now. So that's the reason, one of the reasons is for further care like that, or I think a couple other patients were like immunocompromised patients from transplant surgery or something, so they went down to UNMC. But sometimes it's due to just making sure that they're maintaining their level of care at that hospital so they don't overwhelm their ICU staff like a good St. Francis in Grand Island. They like to maintain around 13, 14 patients in their ICU, and then when it gets to that capacity, then they'll transfer out.
Two more questions. Yeah. Go ahead, Paul. Sorry. Yep, you. Sorry. I thought it was a question back, but it was just somebody scratching their head. You're not supposed to be touching your eyes back there. You know that? Not supposed to be touching your face.
So I got a couple
questions. Caught ya.
Yeah. Couple questions about tests in Nebraska. Concerns, I guess. One is that will these results be shared with the state's existing database on testing?
So the question was, will the data be shared with the state's existing database on testing? So what we're going to do is we have the separate database. Again, it's encrypted. Your personal data is going to be all kept there. If somebody tests positive, then we'll give the person the results back of their test. But if they test positive, we will work with the local public health department to begin the contact tracing. And so the information will get entered into our normal systems through that contact tracing program.
And I've not been able to find this, but apparently somewhere on the website it says that the data in aggregate is sellable or shareable.
The question was, on the website it says somewhere the data is sellable in aggregate or sellable. I don't believe that's accurate, but we can run that down and make sure. Because my understanding is, again, we just had the executives here a couple days ago, right? They all said it wasn't going to be sold. Yeah. Last question. Yeah, Lee. Yeah, so the question was, we want this to go viral, we want people to take it. At this point, we've purchased 540,000 tests, so that's what we want to get done, you know, this year. And obviously, if we have more demand than that, we can work on buying more tests. But that's why, you know, if you're looking right now at, say, 50,000 people, that's only 10% of our capacity to be able to do. So we want to get that ramped up way more. We want Nebraskans to get the assessment. If it's appropriate, we're going to test you, and then we'll trace all the people you've been connected with to make sure they're all isolating, to make sure we're slowing the spread of the virus. And this is going to be one of our tools to be able to do that. Well, again, folks, thank you all very much for coming here this afternoon. Appreciate it very much that you are all here to get these updates. We will continue to give these updates. And again, I want to just thank all the Nebraskans who are working very hard to slow the spread of virus here in our state. And please remember our 6 rules. We got another week left to follow in this. And then also, crush the curve. Go sign up at testnebraska.com and challenge 5 of your friends to do the same. Thanks all, and we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks.